business on BCTV is brought to you by Herbine and Company Incorporated, certified public accountants, accounting for success.
Hello and welcome to Berk's Business. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wachovia Securities. Each month at Berk's Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of the regional business community and ask them questions during our live telecast on Monday night. You can call us at 610-378-0426. Again, that's 610-378-0426 during the live program on Monday night. Our guests tonight are from the Medicine Shoppe of Reading. We have with us Andy Naglack, the owner. Pam Getz is a pharmacy student working with them at the moment. And Scott Wirtz is a pharmacist there as well. Folks, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
All right. Well, let's talk about, Andy, the history of the business and how you got started.
Well, I came to Reading. I sold a drugstore in the Poconos, and I was looking for another store, and I was interested in the apothecary type, and the Medicine Shoppe in Reading became available. Mm-hmm. And I moved down here, purchased the shop, and I've been here, I guess it's about 27 years.
A little while now.
Yes.
And what got you interested in pharmacy?
Well, I come from a little town in upstate Pennsylvania. I worked in a drugstore, just as a youngster, cleaned up at first, waited on customers, and sort of my brother also went to pharmacy school, so that's got me interested, yes.
Okay. Pam, let me ask you the same question. What got you interested in pharmacy?
Well, actually, my cousin's a pharmacist, and she really taught me the impact that pharmacists can make on patients' lives. Physicians know the diagnosis, but we really have the education on the medications, and we can counsel them on how to increase their quality of life, but physicians often cannot.
How is it? Tell me how that, flesh that out a little bit. How does that work?
Well, we have 4 years of education specifically looking at the different, the pharmacokinetics, the dynamics of the medications and how they work on the body. Mm-hmm. Physicians also have that education, however, we go into a little bit more detail. And so we have some time to spend with the patients that we can impact their lives as they take their medications.
And you're probably a little more familiar with what each individual patient is actually taking.
Correct.
And do you often find that the doctors are in their little silos, that they're focused on whatever it is that they're treating?
I think they look at the patient as a whole, and I think they do their job. I think we just, you know, complement them very well.
Okay. Scott, how about you? What got you interested in pharmacy?
Well, really, it was growing up around that environment. Andy is my stepfather, and as I mentioned, he has owned this pharmacy for 27 years. And growing up around him and in the business, I worked there sporadically, growing up cleaning shelves as cashier. Coming out of high school, I really didn't know what I wanted to do, and I thought this was a good opportunity. And really enjoyed science. And once I got into pharmacy school, I really did develop a real joy for it, and I really loved the education and the courses I took, so.
Well, what's involved in pharmacy? What educational background do you need to become a pharmacist?
Well, it depends on where you go to school, for one. Helps to be strong in science especially. There is a math element. But where I went to school, there's 2 years of pre-pharmacy where you take some core courses, right, and then you apply to pharmacy school after those 2 years, which is a 4-year professional school.
Right.
The 2 years of pre-pharmacy is heavily based in science. Most of the various chemistries you take, physics, and then just core courses that the university requires. And once you get into pharmacy school, it's almost all science, drugs affecting the body. You learn about the anatomy and physiology of the human body to start, and then they kind of build on top of that how drugs affect various elements of the body. And Pam's school, a little different. She is at a 6-year program where once you get in, you're in it for 6 years. School I went to, you're in it for 2 years, then you apply to pharmacy school. After you have accepted, and then you finish the remaining 4 years.
So, Pam, how was your educational experience different, or how does it work?
Very similar. First 2 years, I did a lot of science, chemistries, mm-hmm. And then once I started pharmacy school, it does focus mainly on the medications and the dynamics. That's how it works in the body.
So, Andy, what's the interesting part on the day-to-day basis? What makes you get up and say, well, boy, I get to go to work this morning?
Well, first of all, I seem to have controlled my own destiny in working, mm-hmm. and
it's huge.
Yeah, I have a big interest now. We do a lot of compounding,
right,
which is a separate business within the traditional pharmacy. So I just like to do the compounding, making things.
It just appeals to you. I actually sit there and make something that other people just can or won't do.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. We use the old tools. I brought some of them along. I guess we'll discuss them a little later.
Oh, yeah, we'll be getting into that, all kinds of particulars about compounding coming up shortly. So again, I'd like to remind our viewers, if you'd like to call us through the live program at 378-0426, that's when you'll reach us here on Monday night. So Pam, when you actually started your working career, what do you think will be the exciting part of that?
I think pharmacy is different every day. You're going to have different challenges every single day, and you never know what's going to come to you. But you learn throughout your schooling how to, you know, problem solve, and you know, with compounding, it's a problem every day. But it's fun to take the challenge and help the patient at the same time.
Probably multiple problems every day.
Yeah.
Scott, on a given day, how many compounds do you do?
Our particular store averages 70 a day. We'll top out around 120 on our busiest days, which is, from what we've heard, a lot more than a lot of other compounding pharmacies. There aren't many around, which helps. So when a patient needs a compound prescription, there aren't many options to go to. And but there is a need for it. Okay. It's a necessary niche. It's growing, but most pharmacies still don't do it and are in some ways afraid of it. But we're happy to offer it, and that's usually the most rewarding part of working.
Well, when Andy was on the program last time, he was saying about all the different possible ways you can deliver medication. It's whether it could be, you know, liquid or the different forms. Can you tell me why people would prefer one form versus another?
Oh, number of reasons. If they have allergies, for one, to something that exists in a commercially made product, whether it be to a flavoring or an inactive filler. Other patients need a specific dose that a drug company doesn't make. A drug company will make three or four strengths of a particular drug, and that's it. But you might have a baby or an infant who needs a dose that no drug company makes. You might have an adult who needs a specific dose for whatever reason. So really, dosing is the biggest one. Some patients having a hard time swallowing pills. We don't do a lot of veterinary compounding also. Animals are known for that, but some adults even.
Sure.
But the medication arm might only be available in a liquid, or a capsule or a tablet. When you come in and make a flavored liquid, it makes it much easier for the patient to get their medication.
Well, there's a lot of people just don't like to swallow a big old horse pill.
Right.
Yes.
And so you can make that into a liquid or some other form?
Yes.
Super. Well, Andy, let's talk about what is a traditional pharmacy and how does yours differ?
Okay, what I consider a traditional pharmacy is what most people see throughout the country. Okay, you have a pharmacy where you count the pills out, you bring your prescription in, they either count the pills or bring in the injectables and anything along that line. But what I've been finding out is things are starting to change. We have various specialties. A lot of my friends throughout the country, they're going into pediatric medicine for children. Mm-hmm. They're going into diabetic medicine.
As pharmacists or as doctors?
As pharmacists. Okay. They specialize this. There's a need to remember one thing. If a person is sick, they have two choices. Either an emergency room or a pharmacy. So we can fill that niche, get to the patient first, and give them some medical advice. So otherwise, if they go through the physician, you need an appointment, and they have to have a regular doctor.
So if a person is sick in a particular way, they can come in and see you, and while you can't prescribe medicines, you can probably make some suggestions.
Direct them, okay. Yeah, and a lot of people, well, your regular pharmacy, there's a lot of competition, and the chains, the big operations are taking over everything, and their little pharmacies are looking for various pieces of niche work.
That makes sense. Let's see, we have a picture of your pharmacy, so let's take a look at that. There you are.
Yeah. What I did in the pharmacy, on the side of the building, on the left-hand side where there's another door, I built a lab there.
Okay.
So we have essentially four stations to work at. And we can have four technicians or pharmacists working.
And we also have a picture of the inside of the building, but not the lab.
No, I, so unfortunately, I didn't bring a picture of the lab.
So there you are.
Yes.
And Scott in the background there.
Working hard as always.
Scott's doing the work.
So he's the front man and you're in the back doing the work.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's the deal.
Seems to work well.
That's what son-in-laws are for, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Okay, well, thank you. Getting that up there. Okay, let's, so I was new to this concept of a specialty pharmacy. So I imagine if you were dealing at an older folks facility and you're specializing in geriatrics, if you're associated with a pediatric practice, that sort of thing?
Yes. Uh-huh. You can educate the patient, help the families out. And it's just another niche that you have and provide a service.
So as a practice that's primarily oriented towards compounding, how do you differentiate yourselves from the major chains?
Well, we give personal service. Mm-hmm. We actually utilize the chains, and they're very helpful. Compounding takes a larger amount of your time. So if you're working at a busy chain pharmacy, you do not have time to do mixtures and how to make them and the various things that you have to know about them. So what we do is we actually detail the chains. We go in and see the pharmacist and send us their problems and we'll work it out for them.
So that's kind of a nice symbiotic relationship where the bulk stuff that really doesn't interest you that much anyway is what they're good at and they're specialized at it, but what you're doing is the compounding, the hard to do stuff, or the custom and specialty work, and you ask them to bring their problems to you.
Yes.
How else do people find you?
We have a website. Mm-hmm. They find us, we detail doctors.
Okay, what does that mean?
We go through the doctors and we talk to the doctors and explain to them that we do the compounding. Okay, we visit veterinarians because we do a lot of medicines for animals. As I'm talking here, I'm thinking compounding may be a difficult concept for a lot of people. Okay, compounding is just sort of an old-fashioned way of making medicines where we start with powders and we buy bulk powders and we put them into various delivery systems.
Well, tell you what, let's segue into that while you brought up the topic of compounding.
Okay. This is your old traditional mortar and pestle,
right?
Okay. We use this primarily in making liquids now. This is a melamine mortar and pestle. It's very like a plastic, very, very sturdy, and we use it to make liquids. A lot of our ointments in preparation like creams, we make in these ointment jars.
Okay.
This is a mortar and pestle. We use an electric mortar and pestle in the store.
Okay.
Okay.
So you brought this along for demonstration here, but really when you actually do the work.
The machine is too, it's too large. And this is sort of a fancy ointment jar where you can push up the bottom and the ointment will come out. Okay. Or you can use it like the old-fashioned traditional ointment jars where you just open it up.
Okay.
And we have various sizes. Pardon me?
You're zooming in so you can see.
Oh, okay.
You can see it.
Yeah, see, we can push that up and the ointment would come out.
Okay.
Leave this in, open the top, and the ointment can come out and smaller.
So you can hit a custom size
and
blend right there in the store.
Yeah, this would be 30 grams or 1 ounce. This would be 60 grams or 2 ounces.
Right. Ham, what's the machine in front of you?
This is a capsule making machine, and what we'll do is we take empty capsules. You get capsules, in the store that have the powder in it. Well, these are empty capsules, so it's our job to mix the powders together, and we place the capsules in here and put the powder in, and we make our own capsules.
And again, these are all custom formulations that you're making in the store?
Correct.
Super. So how does that machine work?
Okay. This is an interesting machine here. This can make 100 capsules at one time. We have machines that make 300 at a clip. And what we do is we have a loader here.
Yeah.
And it puts the capsules. I better work my glasses. I think it worked a lot better that way. We just load the capsules in this particular fashion. Okay, but it's 100 of them done at one time.
Okay.
Okay.
So you're actually loading whole capsules in there?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Well, you see what we do. Now, there would be 100 capsules, not the three that I just put in, in there, three or four that I did. And then we would just take the top off. You can see the tops are in here.
Right.
We would, we have a another machine which we put them down, put the powders in here, fill each capsule.
So do you literally fill them one by one? Or
no, no, you spread the powder over.
Oh, I see.
And you use a scraper.
Okay.
So it'd be just like a piece of paper like this.
Right.
And you just fill it in, pound it, and that sort. Then you just get this, the top part.
Right. So that fills one
it up.
Half of the capsule. The capsule only half full, or is it like three quarters full?
No, no, it's all. You just fill the bottom part of the capsule. Let me have a larger capsule, and I can show you what we did.
Okay.
And we took the top part of the capsule off.
Right.
So we're filling this part in there.
Okay.
Okay.
He's getting a close-up so you can.
Oh, okay. I'm moving. Yeah,
there you go. You hold still up on you.
Yeah.
There you go. There you
okay,
go.
We just fill that part of the capsule which stays here.
Right.
And we fill the powder in all hundreds of them.
Okay.
And then we put the tops back on.
Okay.
We unloosen this. And you have a full capsule.
Nice.
I probably, now that I didn't think of this, I should have brought a bigger capsule machine and see. So it would be full of powder there.
Right.
And then the capsule filled.
Super. Now, Scott, what do you have in front of you there?
A couple things. This is a dosage form we'll often do for cats. They're notorious for being problematic. They don't want to take anything by mouth.
Okay.
We get a lot of horror stories from owners where cats just, the second they try to come at them with an oral medication, they're out of the room.
Right.
And you can't find them.
So what do you
do? So cats actually, you can apply cream to them on the inside tip of their ears. Just with your finger, often they don't know what's going on. So we'll dispense medicated cream for a cat in these topical dosing syringes. The cream's already in here. I do want to wear a glove because they could absorb the medication themselves.
Sure.
And oftentimes the dose is just small enough to be about 1/10 of this syringe. They just push that onto their fingertip. It's actually a little more than what they would normally apply.
Okay.
And then they could get their cat, rub into the inside tip of their ear, maybe pet them at the same time. Mm-hmm. Cat has their medication and then is just off to do whatever they're doing. So that's a pretty popular one. We can also use these syringes to administer oral medication. These would be good if, imagine this were empty. There'd be a liquid in this bottle, and this cap would then affix to the top of this bottle. And this oral syringe would fit into the cap. You could measure the dose up into this syringe. We can flavor these. We have a 30 to 40 different flavors in the pharmacy that we can go. Some are applicable to animals, some for humans. Often get it right in their mouth, and they usually enjoy it because it's a flavored, they might think of it as a treat and not so much a medication, which they often create problems.
What appeals to a cat or a dog or other animals?
Flavor-wise?
Yeah.
Cats love tuna. We actually, at our pharmacy, we buy cans of tuna at the grocery store and drain out the oil, and that serves as the flavor in the medication. We buy various flavors from suppliers. Dogs love beef, liver, chicken usually. Cats, we have a variety of other fish flavors, salmon, fish chowder, white fish salad. But there's about a list of 20 to 30 for animals that we'll work with. So it really depends what the owner thinks the animal might like,
mm-hmm.
or what the animal and they know likes. And a lot of options, which is one of the great parts of the practice.
So when somebody comes into you and they say, well, I have a sick cat and they need this medication, what do you typically say to them?
Happy to help you. Problem. We do.
Do you ask them what kind of flavor they like?
Yeah.
Do you ask them?
Yeah, if the veterinarian doesn't specify on the prescription, we'll ask them what would the animal like. We'll tell them, give them our more popular options. And they'll often pick one of those.
Right.
And we'll counsel them on how to administer it properly. A lot of times there's questions because this is kind of a unique service that no one's really familiar with. So
exactly.
We'll demonstrate how to use these things at home, and a lot of them are very user-friendly, so get a lot of positive feedback.
So administering a medicine like through a cat's ear, is that pretty common? Or how does that,
In our world it is.
Sure.
Yeah.
And not being a pet owner, I don't know a lot of these things, so.
Yeah, that's probably one of the most common complaints we'll get from a cat owner specifically is how difficult it is to administer a medication by mouth. Mm-hmm. And it's very convenient that a lot of medications, if you use an appropriate base or cream, that the medication dispersed throughout. Really good at getting the medication into the skin through the ear. There's blood vessels right there that can absorb the medication. And it's oftentimes just like they took it by mouth, and it'll work that way. And it's a lot easier for everyone involved.
Let's talk a little bit about the role of technology in pharmacy, because Andy, you were talking about how the machines that you have back at the store really are capable of doing a whole lot more than your demonstration model here. How do you see the technology evolving?
In the compounding or in the regular pharmacy?
Well, in compounding especially.
Just everything is bigger, faster. Instead of mixing with the mortar and pestle here, we have automatic that just takes these machines and you walk away from it and mixes it. And the speed is just phenomenal.
I imagine that would help it with accuracy and quality and all that.
Yes, yeah. And if you notice, we particularly like these because once we put the meds in, we weigh it right on the balances.
Right.
We put all the medication in there. We have like a drill bit that goes in there and just mixes it quickly, and we don't touch anything. Nothing touched, and it's clean, and you don't worry about that. That's another thing you don't have to worry about. But we have things like an ointment mill, grind the particles down. We have all kinds of grinders. Everything's automatic. It's just faster, quicker, and I think does a better job.
So, Pam, what have you learned in your time at the medicine shop compared to what you learned in the classroom?
You know, in the classroom, you learn all about the different dosage forms, the creams, the ointments. But you don't necessarily learn how to make them and how it really affects patients. And at the medicine shop, I've learned, you know, all the different forms you can change a powder into anything.
Right.
It can be a spray, it can be a suppository, and it really helps the patients out. And without this rotation, you know, my eyes wouldn't have been open to everything that's really available out there.
Have you learned a little bit more about how to deal with people?
Yeah. I have, and I've learned how much they appreciate what pharmacists who compound can do because it makes their lives so much easier and it helps their quality of life.
So how do you expect to apply this in your career afterwards?
Well, I'll know who to contact if I need a compound.
Absolutely. Let's talk a little bit about the couple minutes we have remaining about the developing industry trends. I mean, Scott, we were talking earlier about mini clinics being co-located in with pharmacies.
Yeah, just like compounding is kind of a niche for us, a lot of the larger chains have to find other niches to get customers or patients in the store. Mini clinics are a growing trend where it's basically an urgent care clinic where instead of going to the emergency room, you can go there, it'll be staffed by a licensed practitioner who can prescribe medication. Oftentimes this will be for children or people with infections, need just a simple antibiotic or something. It takes up a small portion of the facility, of the pharmacy, and the patients right there, they'll often just get it filled at that pharmacy. So that's one other, and I've called a niche practice that some people are taking advantage of to get more people in the into the pharmacies, but it's a growing trend. I think the jury's still out as to whether or not it'll be effective. It's kind of experimental right now, but that's one thing I'm starting to see around a lot of pharmacies.
So you're seeing a lot more specialization in general?
Yes, and I think that's largely due to third parties and insurance companies have really cut down reimbursement, and it's hard to really make any kind of profit with just prescription drugs alone. So you often have to offer these other services to get another source of income or revenue, and many clinics from one.
So the insurance industry has really changed the way pharmacies work, and so you have to specialize in order to be able to offer the ancillary services to make things profitable?
As a smaller store, we do, yes. The larger chains have the advantage of a larger storefront, separate from the pharmacy. They sell a lot of other products that people may go there for. As just a small retail pharmacy, or like an independent, all we offer are pharmacy-related services. So it's very important to find that niche that kind of keeps us going.
Andy, the 2 minutes we have left, you're affiliated with the medicine shop, and how does that work?
Yeah, we're a franchise. We purchase the right to use their name. They offer us various marketing skills, how to promote the business, just various ideas. They do our books and figures and.
So all that back office software, they free you up from a lot of that,
yes.
And you're free to focus on compounding?
Yes.
So that adds some value?
Yes.
Okay. So how do you see the shop progressing over the course of the next couple of years, and what trends do you see emerging?
In my particular shop?
Yeah.
What I see is a continuation of personal service. Mm-hmm. I see our compounding practice expanding. More and more people are using it. The same size doesn't fit all, so we try to, fit the particular size for the particular person.
I understand you've developed clusters of clients, not just in Pennsylvania, but around the country who are interested in the kind of work that you do.
Yes. We do a lot of mailing, which created another problem. We had to bring in a mailing department, a shipping department in the store. And
that's a good problem.
Everything was new to us, but we're glad to have solved that so far.
Super. Well, I'd like to thank all the three of you for being guests on Berk's Business tonight. Our guests have been Andy Naglack, who's the owner of the Medicine Shop of Reading. Scott Wirtz is a pharmacist there. And Pamela Getz is a pharmacy student now and will be starting her career in pharmacy very soon.
Yes.
I'd like to thank you, our audience, for watching Berk's Business. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director of Wachovia Securities. We're an investment consulting group of Wachovia Securities. We'll see you again second Monday of next month here on Berk's Business.
Business on BCTV is brought to you by Herbine & Company, Incorporated, certified public accountants, accounting for success.